that says that we will break at 6:15 from the dinner and have our agenda begin. And just before we get started, I just wanted to let you know who I am. I'm Marv Evans. I'm the Senior Manager of Regional and Strategic Planning for the CRD. And it's our division of the CRD that has been tasked with overseeing, assisting rather, the Citizens Advisory Group in making its recommendations on a regional deer management strategy to the CRD board. I am Jeff's immediate supervisor, and Jeff Whiteman to my right. You'll get to know him quite well, and you probably already had an opportunity to get to know him. And he's the project manager, so he is the go-to person for this project. And I've distributed my business card so that you have a second go-to person in the event that you have any questions or concerns and you need those answered and Jeff isn't available, then by all means feel free to contact me as well. And over in the corner, just to make sure that everyone's accounted for, is Corey Berger. He's a planning research assistant, and he will be taking notes this evening. We will be posting the notes to the year management website. All of the meetings are conducted in public. However, if there is public in the gallery, they're intended to be observers and not actively participate in the meetings. And the we'll review that in a few minutes when we go over the terms of reference, but there are no delegations permitted to the Citizens Advisory Group as well. So those are the things that I wanted to sort of break from the get-go. Also, until we have the chair elected, Jeff will function as the chair until we get to that item in number 3 of the agenda. And with that, I'll turn it over to Jeff. And just before I do, I want to thank you so much for volunteering your time and your effort for this very important undertaking. And we look forward to working through this with you and supporting you as best we can.
Thank you. I'd just like to echo Mark's thanks. I do appreciate everybody coming out and putting your names forward and applying to dedicate some time to this project. I'd like to start off with some introductions, to just a little bit about yourselves and what interest you have in the Citizens Advisory Group. As Mark said, I'm Jeff Whiteman, I'm the project manager and also the planning analyst for the Regional Planning Division. And I've been tasked with overseeing this this process. So, start to my right, I guess.
Terry Mitchell, Central Saanich farmer, played with deer problems.
I'm Jocelyn Skerlak, and I'm not with any particular group. I'm just very aware that some of poor sod has to solve this problem of the deer.
I'm Bob Moody. I'm a new resident of Victoria, having purchased a property and chosen just 2 months ago. It was my first encounter with a 6-foot-high deer fence around my garden. However, I'll tell you a bit about myself because I've never met any of you before and I am quite new here. So I am a registered professional biologist, have been for 25 years. My first job with wildlife was with the Fish and Wildlife Ranch here on Vancouver Island, studying deer and elk on Vancouver Island. And I've worked on ungulates as a scientist for many years throughout BC. I also did a study for Parks BC on the fallow deer on Sydney Spit Park. In terms of conservation, I am currently the executive director and registrar for the Urologist Association for BC, but I left the job as the executive director of the Grasslands Conservation Council to take this position. I was also the founding executive director of the BC Conservation Foundation. In terms of agriculture, I'm a professional agrologist. For the last 30 years, I've owned 2 farms, 2 ranches, and I've raised kids, crops, and livestock on those pieces of land. Did studies for Richmond and Delta in terms of wildlife conflicts. Locally, I was the chair for the Citizens Advisory Committee for the Corrections Canada and Kamloops Parole, and I'm now sitting on the Citizens Committee here for the William Head Institution in the Chosen. Yeah, I've done a lot of different things, and you're very solution-oriented, and delighted to be here, happy with the new environment. Thank you.
That's a hard thing to follow. bought, and I am a 50% owner in Silver Rill, and we farm about 100 acres on the Saanich Peninsula, and the deer farm about 30 of those acres. I am also the voice of any of the other farmers that have chosen to give any information to me that they think might be relevant or important.
My name is Silkinis. I live in the city of Victoria, and I farm in the municipality of Oak Bay, Saanich, and Victoria. I put up a deer fence today. 8 feet, actually. I don't know if six feet didn't work in our other yards. We have deer in about half of our yards, so it's become a big issue for us, especially. We're small scale, but percentage-wise, it would probably be about 30% as well of our crops last year, at least. I guess I also kind of represent a lot of young people in the city who are trying to grow food in the city and are trying to find a way that we can live sustainably in the local area and grow as much of our own produce and survive at a local level. And so, you know, this is one of these things that we have to contend with if we're going to be eating local and farming local. We've also got another food source that's eating our other food source, so how do we deal with that? So I guess that's where I'm coming from.
No, I see we've got it.
No, I have a problem with that too. But I'm out of work. I live in Willis Point. I'm a retired government employee and a lawyer, and I guess I volunteered for this because I spent a lot of time in my career trying to negotiate or resolve what seemed to be pretty much insoluble questions, native land claims or constitutional issues. And, this looks like an insoluble problem too. I guess the thing is I have no particular vested interest where I live. There are lots of deer. Some people think they're great and feed them. Other people think they're a pain and put up at least 6 or 8 foot fences. And other people kind of want to live with them, but they're worried about them on their own, to be honest. And, I think I get about 2 or 3 per year on the side of the road somewhere. I feel lucky that I had to get one, but it is a problem.
I'm Robin Bassett. I'm also a retired civil servant. I'm a lawyer by profession. I worked with the Ministry of Attorney General. It's my career job, the legal services branch. I had many portfolios, but one of them was to provide legal advice to the Director of Wildlife. I did that for about 8 years in the mid-80s, and I saw some material here on fallow deer, and I can remember giving advice 28 years ago about who owned the fallow deer on James and Sydney Island, so I know about the jurisdictional issues. I know they're complicated. I've also, working within the legal services branch, I was a managing lawyer, so I had to deal with people who were difficult to manage. Lawyers are like herding cats, someone said. So I'm used to difficult issues and being part of a team and, like Patrick, trying to resolve these sort of insoluble problems. I live in Fairfield, and on the application where it said, asked you what your dealings with deer were, well, I can't remember the exact word that was used, I was able to say none. I don't have any deer stories. No deer has ever come into my garden. I've never heard anyone or being chased by a deer or a dog being kicked by a deer or an accident happening on the roads. I have I've seen deer in Fairfield, especially on Fowl Bay Road. I say that just because I come to this with an open mind. I have no preconceived ideas whatsoever. I want to be guided by the facts, the evidence, the science, and not by emotion. And I'm really looking forward to it.
I'm Richard Christensen. I'm the resident of North Saanich. I don't farm. We have a small garden, but it's kept deer free by two German shorthairs. We're very well, one's a million years old, not too active, but the other one is quite active. It's a small fence deer. I guess I bring a bit of a pro hunting slant to this committee. I see there's numerous opportunity in areas where it can be done safely. I know that's not going to provide an ultimate solution, but it is, I think, part of the solution. I think there's a number of different opportunities, both lethal and non-lethal, to get a handle on a lot of problems that here in Victoria has. And like many of you, I just put my hand up to help out as a resident of this area.
I'm Carrie Ward. I've been a resident of Fairfield Gonzales for the past 15 years. And the other area I've lived in the CRD is Michozen. So I've lived there for about 10 years as well. Professionally, I consult to museums, heritage sites, and science centers, mostly doing exhibits and public programming and public outreach. And for the past 6 years, I've been a volunteer at Waldark, which is the Wild Animal Rehab Center at Michozen. And with them, I have been involved in animal care, public outreach, and education on life as well.
Thank you. The first section I kind of wanted to get through was just effectively the meeting schedule as far as times of day, times of the week that work best for you. I used the polling software to determine the best time for this one. I just wanted to get a sense of whether you liked that system or whether or not it was easier to set a meeting schedule. I have a proposed meeting schedule. It's effectively every Wednesday for the next 6 to 8 weeks. I don't know if that works for you. I was just hoping to get some feedback as to when and where and how, or whether you want to just do an ad hoc week to week, meeting to meeting schedule.
At what time on Wednesday?
This time.
The evening.
Yeah.
Personally, for the next 3 weeks, Wednesdays are slightly problematic for me.
Okay.
This time of day works out too.
Okay.
Yeah, same for me. Exactly.
I believe it, are they all correct? turquoise green one in my binder.
Yeah, they're all the same color. Appendix C. So if you go to the first green tab, sorry, the first white tab, clear tab, there's clear tab, and you go back to Appendix C, the Citizen Advisory Council reference.
Turn back from the clear tab one.
Yeah. Looking up to this stuff.
Did you follow that?
Everything else I tagged, just this one I didn't, so I apologize.
Yeah, good.
Clear tab. No, no, just. Appendix C. There we go.
No, this, this.
The other clear.
All right.
Thank you.
Sorry about that. Is everybody, is it found?
It's the first test.
It's actually not.
Clear tab and one clear tab.
So you folks have been tasked with responding to the public's concerns and basically coming forward with some ideas on the regional deer management strategy for the Council Regional District. In doing so, I'll go through the history in a few minutes, but for the most part, it was identified as a problem in January last year in the staff report, and we've done quite a lot of work over the past year. And we wrote terms of we were directed to write terms of reference on November 9th, and we returned back to committee in February with a response. And 40 of these terms of reference are what we returned with. So in terms of the purpose and objectives, our guide is to develop a terms of reference that will guide the control of the deer population in areas of conflict in the Capital Regional District. Coming out of our February meeting, we were directed to prioritize agriculture, and we've got some strong agricultural representation around this table to attempt to mitigate the impact on agricultural crops first and foremost, and minimize the economic losses, and then to identify or address public health and safety concerns related to transportation and deer collisions, and then finally to address the encroachment of deer on private urban residences and their vegetative losses. Another objective is to engage the citizens. We're dealing with quite a large number of government jurisdictions here. There's federal interests, there's provincial interests, and there's regional and local interests. First Nations, the private sector, nonprofits, our goal is to engage all of those, and we'll be mostly doing that through online websites and email submissions. Really very much like to gain the public and local and provincial support for the implementation of a resulting strategy. So in order to do that, we've set out a four-step process that's been identified below. The first part of that was to set up the expert resource working group who met last week for the first time in preparation to discuss some of the materials that you guys will be looking at mostly, but I'll give you a little bit of a rundown on that meeting a little bit later on in the evening. But they're very much made up of technical and scientific experts on deer. We have representation from, sorry about that. So your job is to go through to recommend to the board what you think, or the committee what you think we should do. So I think I've covered off most of the introduction. But so sitting around the table, we do have representation from the Core Peninsula and the West Shore, as well as some members from the farm community. So you've been appointed for the period to which this this will take. Ideally, we'd like to have something back to the board by July. Is the goal. That is a very tight timeline, and hence the reason why we asked you to be able to dedicate 5 hours a week. Realize it's quite a significant portion of time, but to meet our timelines, that's what we require. And to be eligible, you need to be a resident and elector of the Capital Region, and of course, possess a strong sense of community, willingness to work respectfully with the team, and have good communication skills. So, those of you who are absent, and we have a couple of absentee members tonight for three consecutive meetings, forfeits their appointment unless you provide notice and are therefore authorized by the board. And as I said, we'll meet together until the regional peer management strategy has been completed and recommended to the board.
Are there going to be any First Nations representatives?
There are, yes.
Okay, great.
We have representation both here and on the expert resource working group. So our decision-making process will be by consensus where possible, and where not possible, we'll be doing a vote where each person will have, each of you will have this one vote. So our quorum is 7 members, and I was a little nervous when I looked at the poll this afternoon. Not everybody had responded, so I'm happy to see that everybody could make it. And all the minutes and the reports that come out of this will be posted on the website, like I said earlier. We'll be voting for a chair in a few minutes, and that chair will be responsible also for being the spokesman for the advisory group, or spokesperson for the advisory group, speaking only to the media. So no one else on the committee has the authority to communicate with other levels of government or the media on behalf of the region, and it's the primary responsibility of the Citizens Advisory Group is to report to the board. And again, all the minutes will be online. So we would really like to try and restrict, or we will restrict the communications with the media to that one spokesperson. So all other communications that come to you from outside, or may come to you through outside media sources, we would very much like it to be redirected through one point person. So that being said, like to move on to the election of the chair. So, does anyone like to nominate anyone else for the position of the chairperson for the Citizens Advisory Group?
Interesting. You're looking at me?
Yes.
Yes.
you express neutrality, so I don't
have time.
Is the chair, is more time required than other than this committee, do you think?
Not particularly, only to receive a quick bit of media training and to then respond to concerns and if the media requests some input, to be the communications point person.
Yeah, I could just add to that. I think the key there is that we expect that any contact with media will be in terms of clarifying what was discussed or what was generated from a meeting, as opposed to expressing opinion or their own views on the matter. Your views are obviously welcome at this table, but the intent isn't sort of to give free rein to that spokesperson, but the media is really to reflect on the proceedings here and respond to questions of clarification.
And the role of these meetings
is to chair the meetings.
And prepare materials at all?
No, the function of the division is to support the Citizens Advisory Group in that regard.
I really don't think I can do it. I will probably be away for a few of these meetings. I know I will be at the end of June.
serving me well.
I'm very comfortable talking with media, so I am neutral party here, so I'd be happy to be the chair.
I will nominate
Jocelyn.
Nominate Jocelyn as chair.
Second time, are there any nominations?
Yeah, it's the second time.
Thanks, Jocelyn.
Just a question, do you have room for a vice chair in case Jocelyn can't be?
We hadn't
anticipated that. It's not in the terms of reference, but I think that certainly if we do the vice chair, go the vice chair route, it would be to function as a spokesperson for the media, but just to stand in for the meetings.
We nominate you for vice chair.
A couple of things. I can make the time, but first of all, give you my card. I do not represent my employer here. I'm a private individual. Secondly, I am Aboriginal. Thirdly, I am quite an avid hunter, and I used to teach the hunter training course at BC. So if you understand all of that, then I would be the one to do that.
Sorry, is the chair or vice chair?
That's vice chair.
Are there any other nominations?
We'll just hold the nomination for vice chair. So any other nominations for chair?
Okay. So hearing no further nominations. Wait, you said vice chair or chair?
Chair.
Chair.
Do one at a time.
Right. So chair is Jocelyn Sklar.
Skerlak.
Yeah. So I'm sure. And hearing no further nominations, the vice chair is Bob. Okay. Thank you. So the next point is just to give you all a little bit of an overview of the process to date. As I said earlier, when I got my two terms of reference mixed up, this started back in January of 2011 with a report that just identified the issue, and then went through the committee to the board, and we requested at that time that the province take a lead role in managing deer within the capital region. They responded with a letter that they declined to take a lead role, but they would support us with staff and equipment if we ever chose to go down the route of lethal forms of management. And failing that, we opened up an email address in last August of 2011, and at that point we started receiving quite a large number of emails, which is the email address is still open, and so we've asked you to go through a few of those, I think, before coming here, and continue to receive some of those, and we do have done a bit of analysis for you to have a look at, and that's in this package here. And in October, we did a fair bit of research, and we'll go through that research in Section 5 in terms of population trends and collision statistics, human health, community feedback analysis, and of course the BC Urban Ungulate Conflict Report. So in doing so, we continued to receive more and more input from the public based on much of that research. And in November, we were asked to prepare the terms of reference that you have, that we'll discuss actually in the next point. And that came back in February to the committee and the board, at which point we were given some support to move forward and create the expert resources working group and go ahead with the formation of this group. So that being said, if you'd like to turn to the front of the report that we went through last time, we looked at the Citizens Advisory Group terms of reference. If you'd like to flip back a couple of pages on that one, I can go back and start going through what I started to go through previously.
Which one is it, the green tab?
Yes, so it's the green tab again, and it's attachment one. And then finally, deer encroachment on private urban residential properties, resulting in vegetative losses and exposure to risk of deer aggression. We would like to engage the citizens, government, private, nonprofit, and experts, First Nations and farmers, in preparing this action-oriented terms of or action-oriented deer management strategy, and gain the public and local government support for implementation. So to do this, we've developed a four-step process, and as I said earlier, we have formed the Expert Resources Working Group, and they met last week. So based on what they had to say, we've adjusted the materials of your binders relatively minimally. Just to give you a foundational background in all things deer management in BC and the Capital Region, representatives on the Expert Resources Working Group are Parks Canada biologists, representatives from the Ministry of Education, who doubles as our wildlife veterinarian, Ministry of Did I say education? Ministry. What you get for having parents who are teachers their whole life. Ministry of Environment representative, who also represents, who is also a veterinarian. Ministry of Agriculture, we have the regional agrologist as a member, Capital Regional District, of course, University of Victoria Wildlife Population Researcher, and a representative from the Peninsula Agriculture Commission. Yes, and we did add First Nations, and we have also added the SPCA Wildlife Manager to that. So these are people that have demonstrated technical expertise and experience with deer-human conflicts, and who have also expressed an interest in working with the deer management strategy. We did contact a number of others who declined to participate. And we've asked them to consider such things as the factors contributing to overabundant population estimates, annual rates of increase and projected growth, whether, you know, if there is no intervention, documentation of property, agriculture, natural resource damage, and human health and safety concerns, legal ramifications or jurisdictional issues, such as the bylaws, provincial and federal laws, efficacy of management options and geographic project scope. As we'll go over a little bit later, there's certain areas of conflict that we're experiencing, and other areas don't seem to have the same level. The development of the management option evaluation matrix, so part of their role will be to look at how best to evaluate the management options that you have to consider, and also look at the contents of communications materials and surveys. We anticipated quite a bit of public outreach, so just confirming that we've got all our facts and figures straight.
What is the timeline that they're working with?
The same one that we are. So they work.
How
in
their conclusions tied with?
They're very much in a supportive role to this group. So any questions or concerns that come up that I can't answer or we don't have information on, information gaps, that type of thing, they'll be asked to if they have any knowledge, content, research, anything like that to support any concerns or ideas that come to this table. So next is the role that we've almost always gone through for the role of this group, which is working within the scope of the communications and consultation set up in a prepared framework, and effectively preparing and recommending the management strategy and action plan to meet the objectives set out above. So, stuff. So next kind of comes the skip over to the management options. There's a piece that was written for the province of British Columbia, Ministry of Environment. I'm going to get that right before the end of the night. Called the British Columbia Urban Ungulate Conflict Analysis Summary Report for Municipalities, and it was written by a woman named Gail Hesse. And effectively, that lays out quite a lot of detail, what's going on in BC and what our potential options are. I'll go through it in a little bit more detail under point four. But just to give you a bit of an overview, she classifies management options into conflict reduction, population reduction, fertility control, and administrative options. Effectively, there's 11 options that she offers to consider that are in those bullet points on the page over. But basically, the conflict reduction focuses on how to keep animals away from susceptible properties, and that minimizes damage, conflicts, things like landscaping, repellents, fencing, things of that nature. The population reductions are things like relocation, capture and euthanize, effectively reducing localized population densities. But it does make the point that every decision there is very, very community specific and needs to be identified and defined by each community on a case-by-case basis. The fertility control ones are, as she outlines, very limited for BC and Canada. They don't have much available outside the experimental phase, and not very much long-term research has been completed on that type of population control. And there's quite a significant number of fact sheets that echo her position. And that's effectively contraceptives. The administrative options that are offered are effectively bylaws and public education. So basically provincial regulations, local level government bylaws. So we've asked that the Citizens Advisory Group consider all of these options, specifically including but not limited to them. One of the things, you'll have some homework today, and one of those is to go back and identify any management options that are not included in this list that you would like to bring to the table. So, following your consideration of those options, we'd like you to, we'll move on to the preparation phase of the regional deer management strategy, which is agreeing on goals and objectives, confirming an understanding of the management options. The HESI report is rather long, but it is and has been recommended by the Expert Resources Working Group as a very strong document based in empirical science and has a wide breadth of considerations within it. So further moving on, you'll be identifying whether additional management options or measures need to be considered. What are the implementation requirements for each of the management options? And that goes, there's some detail in the HESI report, things like costs and things like that, and community acceptability, public perception, that type of thing. Identifying and addressing information gaps, seeing if there's anything that you need to make a decision that you've been provided with already. Scoping the geographic areas. Again, we'll talk about that a little bit further down. And then you'll be involved in developing the evaluation criteria and evaluation matrix. And then finally, just agree on the format and content within the strategy. So we're hoping to cover that in a very, very tight timeline. So within developing the evaluation criteria and matrix, we asked to consider public acceptability, efficacy addressing documented deer human conflict, short and long-term implications. That's something that's very widely addressed in the report, is, you know, there's, you do need to consider both the short and long-term. It's not one or the other. And then consider the geographic scope of applying these measures, implementation considerations such as amending bylaws, statutes, regulations, licensing, longer education, the duration, and then again the cost. So I was hoping to have a copy of the communications and consultation strategy, but I still didn't receive it back from our communications department with the final edits that we've requested. But basically that insists that we have early and ongoing consultation regarding the strategy. So what we've got is a deer management website set up that a lot of you applied through, and that will continue to be the main point area to receive input from the public and provide information to them going out. So anything in terms of reports, minutes, things of that nature, that's how we will communicate with people, and that's how people will communicate with us. So, it will. I know it specifies an online forum, but that will, for the most part, be the online forum. People will be able to write in, and we will be able to post information with regards to that. So the benefits of this are to allow for public discussion, available through the website, and for the most part, the users will be anonymous, and it'll introduce subsequent stages of the consultation process, provide opportunities for participants to have questions answered, solicit feedback. When we get to a certain point drafting the deer management strategy, we will be looking for more input on it from outside CRD. And we'll have it structured so that the feedback is constructive and solution focused rather than some of the others that can occur. So the step three will be to finalize the regional deer management strategy. So we're aiming for late June for this, based on all the input from us, what we've heard from the public so far through email and information from the Expert Resources Working Group, we'll then be putting all that together and finalizing the management strategy, writing transmittal report, which will be submitted to our Planning, Transportation, and Protective Services Committee for consideration, and then they have the option to recommend it to the board. If at that point they're still not confident with what the recommendations from the advisory group are, they do have the option to go and do a phone survey from the region, which would be statistically significant to determine what management options would be acceptable and which would not. So step four is implementation, and that's completely dependent on, the approved recommendations of the management strategy. One of the things I haven't gone over is that there aren't resources allocated to this. This is something that was taken on outside of any budget considerations, and we've received a single supplementary budget for this year to move forward to do some work for it, but there isn't any long-term sustained budget for implementation at this point. So there's going to have to consider several options from implementation, including those by municipalities. In terms of support, you have myself, who most of you have been in contact with as project manager, and I'm coordinating the expert resources working group. We'll have the corporate communications department here at the CRD supporting as well, and we'll also be providing the administrative and project coordination for the process overall in terms of support online, outreach campaign, and public survey if it goes to that stage.
Jeff, you'll be attending the meetings as well?
Yes. Yeah. So that's kind of it. We're aiming for July 2012, pending the board's approval, and there is a little bit more of a detail outlined in graphical format if you're more spatially inclined on Appendix B.
We ask to meet with the experts, can they come to these meetings?
You certainly could. I don't know if it would be appropriate to bring all of them, but certainly a representative would be happy to come and speak to you. They've also recommended a number of speakers that might be appropriate if you're so inclined to come and just provide an overview to black-tailed deer and what a community process looks like to achieve a management strategy. So after me speaking for quite a while, are there any... Right. So I will turn it over to Jocelyn at this point to chair the discussion on the terms of reference.
I just have one question regarding meetings. Would there be an opportunity to join in the meetings by
We could, if you can't make it, but you would like to still participate, we can make arrangements for that.
Okay. So that's something that might be out of town, but I still have the time mm-hmm. to do it, but I just wouldn't physically be able to be here.
Yes.
There's a huge amount of material to get.
Discuss the conflict analysis
later.
A little in the next point down.
Okay.
So would you like me to take over? And we are now at the review and discussion of materials, correct? Okay, we've done that much already?
We're at the expert resources. We're at the review of the
of the region. Okay, great. So now, what part of that in here is that? Is it somewhere?
So that's the one I've just gone through.
Right.
And that's in the green, the clear tab, and that's the tab.
Thank you. As long as, let me just get my body.
It's, you should be still on the same document we just went through.
Oh, okay.
So this is the BC.
Only just a discussion of it.
Okay.
This sort of missing information.
Okay.
I've read it. I'll be very quick.
So you're a couple of points ahead. We're just going to go back to number four, the second bullet on the agenda.
Just looking at the terms of reference.
So we have to go back here, right? Am I on the right page?
Yes.
There we go. Got it, finally. Okay. Did everybody get this and read it through? We were all sent it before. So Robin, would you like to start with your question?
Oh, well, it relates to this other document. But I guess in terms of the terms of reference, one thing that jumped out was that it was a priority, and that deals with sandwich and agriculture. So in terms of where we go, if that's the first thing we deal with.
Yeah, it's not specific to sandwich, but it is specific to agriculture throughout the CRD. So the agricultural concerns that are posed by here.
Are there any studies, economic studies, as opposed to anecdotal information about what the economic losses are? Is there anything that's written?
We've received a letter from the Peninsula Agricultural Commission that's not this, it is more on the anecdotal side, but it broadcasts a range, or it projects a range of between $5,000 and $60,000 per farm. It should be in this package somewhere.
Maybe while we're discussing it.
But yes, yeah, so they did put a submission in and representing most of the farms on the peninsula.
So I guess then the next question is, what does that represent in terms of a loss? I mean, 60,000 of 6 million, or is it 60,000 of 100,000?
Right, we don't have the...
We don't have that.
From what I recall, it was, well, this was just deer, wasn't it?
Yes.
I thought it was a 100. Because we've been doing some other studies with the geese and that, so. I think just on our farm, we were up over 50,000. Between 50 and 75,000, just on our farm, with carrots and lettuce, let alone all the other small, like the orchard where they break in the branches and that. But to actually, it's okay if I see. Okay. When they walk into a field of carrots, and we grow about a dozen fields of 7-8 acres continuously planting, and it in some varieties, super sweet varieties, we've been down there at 9 o'clock at night, 7 o'clock at night, 2 o'clock in the morning, and there'll be the highest we've counted at there's 27, and 27 deer in one field is a lot. But field there that we may have harvested maybe 60 or 70 or 80 thousand dollars worth of carrots, of 50% for left in the field because of the machine won't harvest them. And as they get washed and graded, the college is throwing out anything with bite marks or broken carrots. It's throwing out. No, maybe there was another field that might have 5%, but we can't, unless we're actually walking up the rows doing measurements and that, we have a pretty good idea what the losses are. But it's not. We haven't done it scientifically yet.
So if everybody has a pink tab in their binder, starting to flip it all the way back to the front of the section, it's section is a big tab.
I do want to say that when I did a presentation to originally at the meeting, I also handed to the committee, the CRD committee, a bunch, I think there were over 20 forms that the farmers had filled out that gave their crop loss totals amounts. And the CRD should have those. If they don't, I have copies of them all and I can bring them in.
So you sent them in to?
I brought them with me to the CRD meeting in February, March?
February.
And I had gathered the information as well as a bunch of petitions that were signed by the farmers on the peninsula. And I had about, it was 20 or 25 or so forms that had the farmers' names, the farm name, and the amount of loss that they had experienced last year to that point. And I've had contact already this year with the farmers that have lost massive amounts of produce already. So it would be a basis anyways of what kind of numbers you're looking at. But
is that Saanich, Central Saanich, and North Saanich? Or that's Central Saanich?
It's the Saanich Peninsula.
Right, but more specifically, Central Saanich and North Saanich, or is it distributed?
No, just not specifically either. But you're looking at, I mean, the large farms, which are, of course, obviously going to experience the biggest losses, are in the Central Saanich area. But the information sheets were sent out to farmers on the whole, well, it was more than the whole peninsula, because it was farmers that were members of the Direct Farm Marketing Association. That was just sort of where I started. I'll start here and send out this information and try and get feedback from all of the farmers. And I do still have that information. That is, it is old information, but it's certainly something to start on.
Request and a question. Could we get some number tabs so we're not showing next week? And I'm curious to know if there's been any information accumulated around the management options within the different municipalities and kind of to correlate those to the problems in those areas. For example, I understand the Chosen allows bow hunting and they have less of a deer call. Do other communities have similar laws, and does that reflect in some way the magnitude of your, can we get that from staff?
What we've got are, the SPCA did an overview of municipalities in BC in terms of feeding bylaws, and they have done something similar in the CRD, and we have printed off the email summary that we received from Sarah, who's actually a member of the Expert Resources Working Group, and that's included in your package.
It's very right near the end. It's a big bunch. I'm sorry, I've been studying this for like 2 weeks. Right here. It's the third yellow tab.
The last yellow tab.
Almost the end.
It's just a one page.
Spell this from what I've seen from their online bylaws. Tend to have either
Can we maybe save the going through the individual details until we've gone through kind of everything, and then we can go back through and visit and see if there's any specific questions? Would everybody be okay with that?
Okay, so back to this, and since I didn't put this together, I'm wondering what is your intent behind some of these. So, the nature of expertise, is this where we're at?
The expert resource working group, yeah.
Right.
So I'm going to go through and give you a rundown on the expert resources working group's first meeting, kind of what was discussed,
right.
Some action points that came out of it, and then talk a little bit about who's on it and the types of things that they're able to offer in terms of support.
Before that, though, were you looking for agreement from the committee on the terms of reference?
I was looking for a discussion on it as to.
Is there any further?
Any questions they had regarding it or anything that could be addressed? I think they've already said before.
Yeah.
Great. So the Expert Resources Working Group met on Wednesday, the 26th of April. And for the most part, they did the same thing that you did in terms of I gave them a rundown as to what the process had been like so far. They reviewed the same terms of reference that you reviewed. They reviewed the terms of reference for this group. And then they had a look and a bit of a chat about what they thought in terms of prioritizing agriculture. And they very much are now waiting to hear what you have and any requests you may have of them. So just to give you a bit more of a rundown, there's one gentleman who's been in the Ministry of Environment, Wildlife, Conflict for quite a long time. So he provided quite a lengthy history as to what had gone on in BC and over the years and the evolution of wildlife management. And then they got kind of into the issues of the need for education and that sort of thing with the public. And from there, they went into what was going on in other municipalities and what the experiences of those municipalities had been from the public realm and the political realm. So what Cranbrook in Vermeer and Grand Forks had been experiencing. Cranbrook being the first, in Vermeer being next, and sort of the public's reaction to that and how those processes had been detailed and worked out. They also reviewed the materials that you have in this binder, and I was at the overall purpose of that meeting very much was to look at what we were going to provide you, that we as the CRD had come up with, and then see if anything made sense in terms of trying to complement it. So one of those things was what Robin was asking about, or sorry, what Bob was asking about for the bylaw assessment as to what goes on at the local level. And so the group is relatively diverse. As I said before, you have representatives from Parks Canada, Ministry of the Environment, who also doubles as a wildlife veterinarian, Ministry of Agriculture, regional agrologist, a former wildlife manager for Ministry of Environment with 25 years of experience, a UVic wildlife population researcher, and the SPCA wildlife manager and a First Nations representative. So,
the UVic wildlife researcher, do they have a specific species? Are they a generalist? Or what?
He operates between BC and Alberta, but focuses on blacktail coastal and white.
SCG.
Yeah, and whitetail interior in Alberta.
Okay.
So, that's more or less who you have at your beck and call to support you and answer questions and technical expertise and stuff like that. And anything that they don't know, hopefully they'll know where to go to find it.
Do they have anyone there who, or any information on how things were dealt with at UVic and the rabbit population?
No, but
terms of public perception and all that, it seems to me like that's a pretty
I was at a wildlife conflict conference and met the gentleman who oversaw that process, and I think he'd be happy to come and speak to you about that if that's what you would like.
Can we have an indication of who'd like to hear from speakers to come and talk? Something like the rabbits.
Can I make a suggestion, Madam Chair? Scooting down the agenda to number 6, the intent is because you're getting this binder sort of cold here this evening.
Right.
To try and cover all the material and come up with the gaps in one evening. That was something that we had anticipated for next meeting once you've had a chance to cozy up with this at home and go through it, and then identify those types, exact types of recommendations that you can bring to the meeting next time around, and then have that discussion through the chair to determine who or what additional materials or speakers you would like us to bring to you, because as you can appreciate with this sort of very short timeline, we need to act on that quickly and really want to get the best, the most germane information to you, so that we can, we're really right at that divergent stage where we're into the, trying to bring all of the information together, and pretty quickly we have to go to the other converge on.
Right, understood.
A suggestion or a question. It seems to me that, or I would be surprised if nobody's written anything about how you have dealt with the monies, whether the guy in charge or somebody. And in a lot of ways, it would be as useful, I think, for us to get something that's written on it as it would be to have somebody come in here. Presentations tend to yield a fair bit of time, and I don't think we have a lot of meeting time. So my inclination, I guess, would be to find out what's available in writing on that or anything like it and get that to us. And then if you have questions and wanted to bring somebody in, at least it would be focused and it wouldn't be a general one. And I guess on a similar note, I was wondering, after Bob's question about economic impact, whether that's something any of the experts might be able to investigate, I guess, or explore, whether there has been any economic analysis done. Not necessarily on the peninsula, but anywhere. Mm-hmm. But the basic principle would be the same. I would think this much damage or that much. It wouldn't be specific to here, but I guess the context.
Curious to know if the expert resource working group elected a chair or spokesperson. That would be a good person to come and speak to us.
They will, depending on what the concern is, they will most likely nominate somebody to come and speak, depending on what your concern is or what you would like to hear about.
Okay.
Regarding the bunnies, Sarah DeVlade at SPCA also had a lot of involvement with that as well, so she'd be a good resource for that as well.
Now, my perception is that if we have questions that we want to put forward to the expert committee, that we will do that at this meeting or next meeting or whatever, and then if you will take it to them and then bring it back to us the following meeting. I would like to suggest that, because you're looking now at 2 weeks to get basically 2 weeks to get the answer, or well, even a week to get the answer, and you're on a 6 week kind of schedule here, is it possible that something could be emailed to us ahead of time so that we would have a chance to look through some information before the next meeting?
Mm-hmm. And the expert resource working group has also agreed to do the same thing and review questions over email.
Mm-hmm.
So I don't necessarily have to convene a meeting with them.
Unless it specifically
unless
was requested,
they
yeah.
need to, so yes.
Because I think that would be a really good way to go, and then you can, pop an email out to us all, and then we'd be able to look through it before we came back to the next meeting.
Mm-hmm. Richard?
So I have a quick question about your UBIC bunny issue. Would you want that speaker to come in just from a public perception point of view or from a toll management point of view? Because bunnies and deer are two totally different critters, right? They dealt with them totally different ways.
And they were a domestic species as well, but quite different from wild species.
Perhaps the thing about the bunnies issue is to learn from them what were some of the biggest hurdles, because that was so controversial, as is this.
So we could I can arrange to do a quick rundown with the overseer of it and get some materials, and then if the materials warrant a talk or a presentation, then you can make that decision after I do a little background.
Right.
That sounds good.
Because
yeah.
I think exactly. If we're going to look at the buddy issue as an indicator of how you can deal with the deer issue, I don't think that will go very far other than just from a public relations point of view.
Yeah.
And those bunnies all resulted from domestic rabbits being released into the environment.
So. I was thinking of it more in terms of public perception.
And they were all relocated.
So I might have a question for you, Jeff, and that is there, like we've talked about the geese, and we're talking about domestic versus wildlife, is there a plan that you're tending to favor that you know, that's like, I don't believe in reinventing the wheel. If there's knowledge out there, why waste time? Time is of the essence. Is there something there that you feel is, you could point to and say, this is working, or we know this has worked?
The geese management strategy, or the goose management strategy, has evolved in very much a different way than most other wildlife management plans would. It very much was a grassroots effort that was brought forth by a group of nonprofits. So they're still in the stages of researching before they make an action. So I've included some of their terms of reference and processes for us to have a look at, because their process is not too bad as far as I'm concerned. But there's, because as I outlined in the terms of reference, because the options are so community specific, you do have to very much look at it from the perspective of the community. We have provided other examples from Cranbrook and in Vermeer and Grand Forks, but there's, you know, the idea is to look for points in there that make good sense and that you like, but not to wholesale cut and copy something from a smaller municipality.
It might be some from here and some from there. Right. Okay. Thanks.
Sure. Just one question. The other towns or districts in the province, I'd be interested to know, you know, what their plans were, but I would like to know what their problems were. What was the agriculture? Was it, confrontations with deer? Was it accidents? I'd like to know what the cause of their management plans were.
Okay. I believe they those should be outlined in the terms of reference for the city of Cranbrook, Grand Forks, and Helena, Montana, which the city of Cranbrook very much based there.
Okay, so that's
in your
if you can find it for you.
Karen, question.
Thanks. And can you tell me why specifically it was, were deer studies looked at anywhere else outside of BC or the US, the rest of Canada, and why specifically it was narrowed down to BC? What people have done?
The HESI report actually does go quite a lot broader than BC and Canada. It steers to the United States because the United States does have quite a longer history than Canada does in terms of wildlife management.
Yeah. Okay.
So a lot of the language in there reflects the history of the United States.
And Jeff, you had mentioned HESI report was...
It's 60 pages. It's not really...
60, oh,
it's,
okay.
not, it's not too bad.
Is there any way to see a copy of
We didn't print it off online. We didn't
online,
print it off,
yeah,
but it is online.
It's online.
Is it online?
It's
in
the binder. Great. Thank you.
Part of the reason why the binder is so thick.
It's because of the
binder.
Well,
there's lots of them. Okay.
Thank you.
Yeah.
Thank you.
I think what the Cranbrook deer issue is more of an urban deer issue versus agriculture, because mostly agricultural problems, these cuckoos are all related versus like me.
Well, I've just come back from Philadelphia, and the the newspapers are full of complaints about the deer problem, right, in Philadelphia.
Yeah.
So it's all over.
A lot
yeah.
of eastern, the U.S. is huge deer people complex just because yeah. of the sheer population of animals and the sheer population of people. So.
Can we move along to review of discussions and materials, please?
Yeah, so the first one here is a popular topic, the HESI report, which we have talked about, but it effectively, just to give you a brief summary, it identifies the conflict and why ungulates are so present in urban areas, and further goes on to show examples of urban ungulate management projects in quite a wide number of jurisdictions. Looks at biological, social, administrative challenges of managing them, and it actually does have quite a strong discussion on residents' opinions of how wildlife needs to be considered when developing an urban wildlife management program, and then it goes through in length the options, so the four. Well, the 11 options within the four categories there. And it looks at things from a view of the cost, human health, safety, humaneness, advantages, disadvantages, that type of thing. So because I'd like you to read it, I won't give you too much of a what's what and who's who in the zoo, but it is and has been highly recommended by the expert resources working group. So if you can flip to a pink tab, the very first pink tab in your binder, you can have a look at the population trends that we've dug up for the lower Vancouver Island for.
So you're looking actually at
just
from
the tiny.
That little.
Yeah.
That little.
Yeah.
Oh, that. Wow.
Little
extra.
And it's 8.5 by 11, or sorry, the 11 by 17 for. Behind it. So these are the population statistics, and you'll have to look a few along to find the coastal black-tailed deer. It should be off here at the page of your binder. These are pre-hunting season counts for southern Vancouver Island outside of urban areas.
Well, it's only southern Vancouver Island.
This one's all of it. So there's a very large range here between 45 and 65,000. These counts are done by the Ministry of Environment on twice a year, usually pre-hunt and post-rut. And so what you're looking at there is very much a loose number from the perspective of the CRD, but it is very much all we have and all we have to go on. What you should be looking at is the estimated trend, which is steady to increasing.
So there's nothing specific to Southern Vancouver or the CRD?
Can we get those numbers?
That is something to be considered, and that might be something that's one of the first implementation items of the deer management. So over the page, we went to ICBC, and if you actually, so the expert resources group thinks that as much as these graphs make an impact, if you go two sheets over to a map, it's on the back side. That very much demonstrates the impact of vehicle deer collisions reported by ICBC. That being said, the SBCA Wildlife Conflict Manager requested that I explain to you that oftentimes when people are drinking and driving, they'll claim that they saw a deer. And
it got away.
Yeah, and that type of thing, and use deer as an excuse. Yeah, you know, or the possum, or what have you. And also that there's quite a large number of animals that they see that are reported to ICBC.
So these little numbers that are on here, are they actual contact with a deer, or they're just
reported?
Okay. So okay.
So that's reported.
So in addition to that, if you flip back to Appendix B, two pages back, you have the Wildlife Accident Reporting System, which is the numbers 111-PJOR. And these numbers are reported to Ministry of Transportation and Infrastructure. And so these are numbers that are actually based on highway cleanups, not the local roads. We're in the process of requesting each municipality to submit what their local road cleanups are, but these are numbers based on the highway.
And these are fatalities. These are fatalities.
Yes.
The highway, so that's East Saanich, Pepe Highway.
Yeah, so it's Highway 1.
West Saanich.
And
17. So when I look at Saanich,
17,
114. I'm like, it's 300 and something. Is that in a year or?
So the ones at the very top, or the page over is ICBC reported collisions by municipality.
Okay, so
between 2000 and 2010.
So you're saying those are the ones that could be possums as well?
If it's more solid. Anything from ICBC is simply a report.
Report, oh, okay.
So it's not research. I would be interested to, when they talked about the highway, because the way I understand it, West Saanich Road is part of the provincial highway. No, any more than you know. Okay.
So when a deer gets hit in the line at the side of the road, who's responsible to pick it up?
Depends where it is.
Is it the municipality though?
Generally, yes. They all have a contract out.
So has anybody ever asked the municipalities how many deer they collect?
Like I said, we're in the process of trying to assess.
Okay. The other one to check would be, at least in my area, and others, is the highway contract for main road. Because there is no municipality, it's a large area, so highways does it. But I'm just looking at the chart, and it shows Willis Point Road has no accidents in 10 years. I know half a dozen people through. And typically, you don't report it.
That's the WARS report. If you look at the bottom, I'm sorry to interrupt, but look at the bottom, there's the Ministry of Transportation WARS report. That's the Wildlife Action Reporting System, which is the information that Jeff had mentioned. And I've included in the binder preface and table of contents from the WARS report. And if there's any one of the things, if there's any bits of that you'd like to use, you can have a massive report. I think my dollars really would probably double the binder. I'd really love to be forever with that. So I just thought I'd mention that. That is something.
Well, it's just been my experience to see a lot of deer be hit, bounce off the side of the road, and hobble away. So, if that happens, does ICBC, and there's no witness, would they include that in their report?
Only if the owner of the car reports it.
Right.
So
here's
how it works. You have an accident and you say, I went off the road because I was avoiding a deer. That's your own accident. That's considered own fault. If you hit a deer, that's not your fault. ICBC will take that as an unavoidable accident. You don't pay the deductible. So it becomes a big deal whether you can find the body, I guess. But I also think a lot of people don't report.
because the deer went flying and ran off, he kept driving. He didn't even get out of his car.
So there'd be no fatal accidents, is that? And it says here there are 8 injured victims in a 4-year period. Property damage only 245.
Is that a board view?
Deer collision severity to humans within. Oh, this is within British Columbia. Oh, and then at the bottom it's within the CRD. Yeah.
Right.
So it's 8 injured victims and no fatalities within 4 years. In 4 years.
Previous to that, there was.
This is up until 2007 as well. And there's a huge increase in the deer population between 2007 and 2012. Which is unfortunate because it may not be really, really accurate, this particular.
But what are your statistics? You saying huge increase. Where are the statistics for that?
What? They're in my backyard. Like, no, I don't have a document of statistics.
Right.
No, I don't. But when I look at the amount of deer that are visible, they probably have. I don't know, would you say close to tripled in the last 4 years?
But is that increase in deer population or loss of habitat and the deer are more visible? Because there's been huge growth in the Capital Regional District and huge development. So the habitat for the deer, there's huge losses of habitat, so the deer have nowhere to go, so they're getting squeezed into a smaller area. Is the deer population actually increasing? Is there?
Yes, because you can see the fawns every year.
But
the
fawns are there
twins,
before. They always have twins.
Well, we've seen more twins than probably the last few years than we've seen in the last 10 or other places.
Yeah,
don't we need some statistical help here rather than guessing?
Yeah.
So, you know, the trend in the HESI report, the trend is, well, I can't remember when I saw it, but the trend is up, stable to increasing, was that the word that was used?
Mm-hmm.
So I guess we need an expert opinion on what does that mean in terms of the future numbers. Is it possible to project or is it not possible?
We don't really have a baseline to project from for urban areas in the capital region.
So those statistics didn't include the urban areas?
Which statistics? The
45 to 65.
Right, that's correct. That's outside of urban areas.
That's outside of urban areas?
Yes.
I think it's been referred to as a population. I've seen it, I've read it several places and heard on the news or in the paper from local game wardens or wildlife control that due to less predators and, you know, less hunting, that there is an increase. That's the only thing I have to go on, other than BC.
The issue is, you know, I don't think we should be guessing. If we don't know, then let's say we don't know.
Mm-hmm.
If we can find out what the figures are, then let's find them out.
Right, and in fairness, I think what we've tried to do that, and this is the best available data that we have. And so that, as Jeff mentioned earlier, might inform part of the strategy in terms of, you know, we may have to sort of back up a little bit and maybe start from a different point than some of these smaller communities where a more accurate assessment of the localized population has already been prepared. So that may just inform how we
It would seem to be helpful as well to have some idea about range, because I understand the urban pressures, but not where I live. There have been 2 houses built in the last 5 years, and essentially no other development. But at least what I see anecdotally, the population is way up from it, and whether that's just coming down, leaving behind.
There are some range statistics and some range estimates in the binder.
Okay.
There's a biology overview of coastal blacktail deer and range.
Is that one? Well, I guess we'll find out when we read through it. But
it's as accurate as could be supported by the biologist 6 weeks ago.
Okay, that's good.
We'll speak as a biologist then. Generally, multiple births are a reflection of that. It's living on a very high nutritional plane, so they've got lots of good food. The population will be increasing because of that.
I have a question too. Is the more conflict between human and deer due not just to loss of, like we shoot every natural predator and they're carted away pretty quickly, but not just because they're no natural predators or fewer allowed to live in the area. The conflict can be happening possibly because these are second and third generation deer who are familiar with human beings, so they don't scatter and disappear. So we're seeing more of them, but have they always been there?
They're more habituated.
Yes.
Just another biological comment. And the major studies on elk that were done in the Kootenays called those elk that were living on the farms homesteader deers. And they were many generations of elk habituated to those conditions. So it's a learned behavior.
Possible to get from the CRD perhaps something about growth in, say, the last 10 years in the CRD area and densification and increased development? You must have maps and statistics on that kind of thing, just to show how the region is changing and perhaps influencing certain areas of wildlife?
Yeah, I mean, we keep pretty close statistics on that type of development, but
has anyone looked at the correlation between human development and human increased population of the CRD and deer, perhaps, increasing the conflicts? And that's why there appears to be more conflicts, because there was a lot more people in the CRD and there was a lot more development and growth.
We haven't done that analysis specifically, but we do keep track of whether densification takes place, so we would be able to look at that.
I noticed Saanich has the biggest number of deer collisions, and in Saanich, has that population increased more, perhaps, than other
areas? Now, would you like the population, or would you like the number of dwelling units?
Probably dwelling units, because that, could you get both?
We could get projections, probably, for the census here.
Probably more relevant, though, to look at on a geographical level in terms of habitat loss, not really number of dwellings, because you can build a condo on a place that had no trees on it, and it's not going to make any difference to the deer population.
Yeah.
And yet you've got 300 people as opposed to one.
Absolutely.
One of the things that the testing report talks about is biological carrying capacity, and that's haven't reached the carrying capacity, then there's room for the deer to increase. I guess it's just the fundamental idea. So if you're getting twins, for instance, it means that there's lots to eat and there's the population is likely to increase. So if there's any sort of expert evidence in terms of, for instance, in Saanich, where are we with regard to the biological carrying capacity? Do they have any idea as to what Saanich can support in terms of increase? When does the herd start to decrease simply because it's getting unhealthy?
Well, as far as the biologists are concerned, it's hit the biological carrying capacity due to the number of accidents that are occurring in the ways.
Okay. So.
And that's what they refer to actually as the biological or the cultural carrying capacity,
right.
Which has been established just due to the conflict. So now, in an urban area, the biological carrying capacity, as far as the biologists are concerned, is relatively unlimited because there's a large, very large number of foods and very few predators. And those are the two major impacts of bahaman carrying capacity.
And as long as you're going to have nurseries selling shrubs, you're going to be continually perpetuating the supermarket for deer or so.
If you have more people growing more gardens and things too, there's less the number of people increase. Urban carrying capacity of deer is going to increase too.
And that was one of the things they were talking about here as a strategy. I was suggesting to ways that people could grow things that aren't food for the deer in order to decrease deer population.
Can we move along here to the human health issues?
The reaction from the expert resources working group on this was very much alarmist. There is next to 0% chance of anthrax being transferred between deer and humans, and tried to chalk it up to being alphabetized inappropriately, but they wouldn't let that out that easily. Really, the biggest concern here is Lyme disease, and in terms of Lyme disease, there's 2 occurrences per 100,000 in the human population, and although that's the second highest in British Columbia, it's a concern. But they didn't like the emphasis that we had placed on all the others, because every other one in here, aside from Lyme disease, has a very minute percentage chance of being transferred between deer and humans. We were trying to do our due diligence and cover all of our bases, and they were very much of the opinion that although there's an outside chance of these health issues being contracted as a result of deer, it's not at all likely. They did want to specify that Lyme disease is the most common and the most likely.
And so, Jeff, 2 per 100,000 is CRD or provincial?
CRD.
CRD.
Oh, sorry.
I have heard
that Southern Vancouver Island. Sorry, 3 per 100,000.
3 per 100,000.
I have heard that there's some controversy about Lyme disease being underreported.
Okay.
There is a fellow David Cumley. He used to be in MLA.
Yeah.
Where is he? I haven't noticed because I've seen it on Facebook, but I know there is a group of people who feel that Lyme disease is a much more serious problem than
Lyme disease is very prevalent around Philadelphia, and it's a big concern to people. And I know a few people who have got it, and you don't often realize until it's quite advanced that you have it.
Yeah, it's quite an underdiagnosed
biology. Yeah.
Yeah,
I have a friend who lives in North Saanich, and she is a nurse at the Jubilee, and she's had a heck of a time getting Lyme disease diagnosed, and it's a doctor in Vancouver has diagnosed it. It's Lyme disease, but she couldn't get anyone in Victoria to diagnose it. So there's a disagreement in the medical community as to whether it exists.
There is a system where my daughter lives in Philadelphia. I'm here, in case you're wondering. But my granddaughter got a tick in her head, and there is a helpline that you phone just for that. And then they give you. She was on the phone for 45 minutes with the nurse. And she got this. Is this happening? Da da da. It was an incredible process. She's fine, by the way, but she. if it is something that is a major concern there, and it's related to the deer.
Yeah, and I think Lyme disease is far more prevalent because it's from Lyme, Connecticut, is what it was named after. So it is an Eastern
there,
based,
yeah.
And there's real disagreement whether it's this but people who have it will tell you that it does, that they have Lyme disease. And there is a doctor in Vancouver who specializes in Lyme disease. And people from Vancouver Island with Lyme disease deal with him because they can't get the doctor.
Just to further add to the health section, a couple, Sarah Dubois, the SPCA manager, and Helen Schwansey, the wildlife veterinarian for Ministry of Environment, are working on editing a copy of this health document. So we'll hopefully have an update back to you on a pared down version of this that's more likely and reasonable for the CRD. So moving on to the community feedback and analysis. So back in August when we opened up the email address, we received initial waves of mostly people that were having issues in terms of gardens, farms, traffic accidents, health, things of that nature. And then as our process became more and more evolved and advanced, it became more and more public. And we've lately, as of late September, early October, have begun receiving quite a large number of input in terms of deer appreciation, supporting a non-lethal form of management and kind of just living with the process and trying to fence and that type of thing. Quite a large number of people from outside the regional district. So a lot of the graphs you see in here represent a combination of inside and outside CRD input and feedback.
I will mention that there's two snapshots in time for the community feedback. The one in black and white came with the deer with the thing with the terms of reference. It's the snapshot of time that went to the board. The very front of your binder, there's a colored page. That is a snapshot in time of immediately, very, very front of your binder before any tabs. Here, you'll see an Appendix C. That's current as of 4 p.m. this afternoon. So that is information. And if you flip over the page, there's actually a timeline analysis based on the six different areas as well.
When you say a fair number coming from outside the region, how many are you talking about?
Close to 400.
Yeah. 400 of?
No, those are what the analysis you're seeing on this page is ones where it is either known to be in region or they did not specify a region.
Okay.
The vast majority of the, I'm the one that handles most of the amendment in the last couple of months. The vast majority of the ones that have come in outside of the region have been through a form response. And those all have been easily identified because they're actually a hand letter that we receive. So it's very easy to see this person's postal address is not within the capital regional district or some areas immediately surrounding it.
So the 657 responses are thinking that it's likely from the region.
Likely from the region, or they didn't identify where they were from, so we included them in this.
So I don't know how many of you have actually looked at the submissions online. They're now broken down by reporting period, so you can see between August and October, and then October and November and February, just how many and what types, and you'll be able to see pretty quickly what the form letter looks like and the types of responses that we've received and likely to involve.
And are these anonymous, or they have to?
Some are, but for the most part, they do write their names and addresses at the bottom. But for the purposes of the public record, we've redacted any sort of contact information.
I think I know what you mean by deer appreciation.
Anti
There's a large notion that this process is going to skip straight to lethal means and not follow the process that we've laid out. And so without quite a lot of information, some people have jumped to the conclusion that that's where it's headed, and the mere consideration of it is not something they like the sound of.
So is it possible that our conclusion would be to do nothing, carry on?
Status quo is one of the options for the pictures.
So is that a fair way then to categorize the people who give us their appreciation, they would support the status quo? Or is there something else about
any non-lethal means effectively? So anti-feeding bylaws, fencing, lower traffic, lower speeds in known deer corridors for traffic, wildlife corridor crossings over major routes, things like that.
That doesn't mean to say that the other 60%, whatever it is, wouldn't agree with some of those options.
They didn't overtly state it.
I have a question about the materials. Is there anything in here specifically about, because obviously agriculture is a problem, and it's been identified by the expert committee as the highest priority to look at and consider. Is there anything about specifically about agriculture and deterrence in the rest of BC, Canada, and the U.S.? Is there anything in here about that, about what other farmers have tried or agriculturalists?
There isn't a specific agricultural document. There is some mention in the HESI report, and there's also some information sheets that were provided by the Ministry of Environment, just in terms of information, and some of those go into farming. There was some documentation from the conference that I could track down. It was more with regards to white-tailed deer, which are a slightly different species and have slightly different behaviors, but with regards to orchards in the interior. But the result of that was electric fencing. And so there's some documentation.
So there's no known methods that can help, that anyone can look at and examine, that no one's, this is so brand new that no one has.
For the most part,
it's been
fencing, and it was my understanding that historically the province had offered some subsidy for fencing in some areas of BC, correct?
It was in the environmental farm plan that applied.
But it was still pretty minimal.
It was minimal.
Like it was like 20%.
Yeah.
Well,
cost,
if you're looking at
cost,
$600,000 to fence
yeah.
properties, then 20% really is not much.
There's many of small farmers that have done it, you know, 1 or 2 acres, because if the deer get in there, they have, you know, that they lose everything in that small acres. But as far as the larger farmers are concerned, they lose a lot of land on the, you know, farmable area, road allowances. Any of us farmable allowance to keep it clean.
Right.
Or we can't put a fence on that. Keep it back, you know, so far ahead, and height restrictions. It's very, you know, it's unappealing for a farmer to be working on fences, mostly unless you keep an eye on the zoo.
And does the environmental farm plan still offer that?
No.
Most of the work that I'm aware of with agriculture and wildlife conflicts are larger parcels of land and less rural settings, so ranches in the interior of the countries. We have quite a unique situation here because the farms that we're looking at are so close to cities and relatively small.
It sounds like just preliminary, this shaken up, the committee could possibly be coming up with recommendations for agriculture and urban. They're two very different things.
That was a proposed option as well, yeah. That there might be the necessity to carve off a subcommittee from this, yeah. Focus on agriculture.
Yeah. I seem to recall at the CRD meeting, that could be in this letter, the emphasis was on agriculture, mm-hmm. And the flower eaters was kind of down on this point, possibly.
Yeah.
Do we have the authority to create a subcommittee? We can do that.
We could make it as a recommendation.
I think that my sort of understanding with the whole reason that they didn't actually do that, that the CRD didn't actually make two committees, was because they felt that they would have to go gather all this information twice. So all the information that we're gathering here and then look at it in two different lights instead of two different whole processes.
Sure.
Yeah, and just to add to that, I think the other idea was to ensure that that there was that cross-understanding of both urban and rural issues by the old committee, so that as you're making the recommendations, you have an appreciation for both types of issues.
Yeah. One is people's livelihood versus...
Well,
pretty gardens.
Well, that's where your education comes in, because people don't understand. They don't realize that I've been pushing this for 3 years. There's a difference between the urban deer population and the rural deer population. And I think you see more opposition, of course, in the urban areas than you're going to see in the rural areas, as far as the citizen. Yes. And that's also a difference. There's a different conflict there between the deer appreciation people and in each area.
Per capita, too, you've got a lot more people in the urban areas being affected. So. The last one, Ministry of Transportation.
The WARS report, we've kind of gone over that a little bit already in terms of the results. It's basically the Ministry of Transportation's way of logging the wildlife accidents in the region. And traditionally, they have done the cleanups themselves. And the reason we picked up on some of these numbers was that they were able to assign a value to the cleanup per animal. And so they assigned it as per small, medium, large animal. And deer classified as medium animals, and so each deer that's cleaned up from the highway runs roughly about $100. When we were trying to quantify some of this stuff, we ran into this wildlife accident reporting system. And so as we went over a little earlier, so you can the second red tab in your binder will take you to the document, which gives you a bit of an overview of what it's all about. And so they've been collecting information since about 1978, I believe, and it's mostly to provide data to the Ministry of Highways as to what's going on and what highways require what sort of mitigation techniques in terms of fencing or overpasses. And it mostly came out of the interior, but has stretched across the province now. And so they're now using it to actually try to control traffic and forecast accidents and identify risk profiles on corridors and things of that nature. So you can have a look through that. I believe it's also available online.
It is, yeah.
And so if there is some interest, the issue is that as far as at the provincial level, the number of accidents that occur on Vancouver Island is relatively minimal compared to what you get on the Coquihalla Highway and other areas like that in the province. So
We do have information on the highways, but it's definitely not their focus, and it's very much tied to ICBC.
It's 10 after, and we're a little bit ahead here. Mm-hmm. Would anybody like a 10-minute stretch, or do you want to slog on through and go home early?
I prefer to slog
through. Show of hands, who wants to stay and keep going?
So this shouldn't take too long. This is basically what I would like you to do for next meeting, and I'd like to have sent out a survey before I fit up the proposed meeting schedule for meeting next week, and I'd like to be able to discuss the contents of this binder by the middle of next week. So I know that probably impacts your weekend significantly, but. There is quite a lot of information in there that I'd like to have a conversation about and know that you've read and understood. And while you're reading through it, and especially the HESI report, which outlines all the options, just keep it in the back of your head. Additional management options that aren't mentioned there, and anything that you think might not be on the table that should be. And finally, we got into it a little bit tonight, but I'd like to. Once you've gone through all this and you have it all rattling around in your head somewhere, to look and think, now, okay, what information hasn't been presented, and what would you like to see, and then I'll hopefully be able to send it out to the expert resources working group if I don't know it, and come back with some answers as to whether it's possible or whether we're going to have to find something to substitute your request.
Can you just go over the stuff that we've, as a group, have already asked you to gather?
Right. So I've been asked to get the data from crop losses that you submitted to our board secretary. I will get some numbered tabs for the binders. I apologize again. I'll try to track down materials for the UVic rabbit process. I will request from the Expert Resources Working Group economic analyses for deer impact on agriculture. And any other materials that I do receive, I receive before next meeting, I'll send out in advance. And it may take a few days, but we'll do our best to provide a development activity map in terms of dwelling units and population. Focusing on what would be habitat loss and green space loss within the Capital Regional District for the past since 2000.
We discussed earlier about the numbers of deer for Bank of Round. Could we approach the Minister of Environment, say if they had numbers for Canal Hassel or how they categorize the islands?
Okay, yeah. We've gone to them quite a few times for more focused numbers and they just don't know. These are their geographies that they work with, the regions they work with, and they just don't know.
Any other questions for Jeff?
One of the things about Appendix E under that, this little one is it's hard to have and pound statistics. I assume that reflects the number of calls as that around as that go get here. But it's only 2010.
The Capital Regional District, I believe that's our pound.
Well, if it's pound statistics on deer and sandwich, but maybe that's
and
still
so continues. They only started collecting statistics in 2010. It's not one of their requirements, it's not one of their mandates to document a lot of that stuff, but when something of note starts to occur, they begin to collect information on it, and so that's what's occurred here. So we had it, and therefore we provided it.
Okay.
Any further questions?
I just had one. Feedback, community feedback. Deer management recommendations. You give us a percentage here, but. Do we have any of their correspondence?
It's online though, isn't it? Is it?
No, not the spreadsheet, no.
Maybe that would be something you could email us then.
We would have to, we did track a lot of names in there, so I think we would probably just submit the recommendations to you instead of the whole.
That'd be good.
Did I hear correctly that the dear appreciation, Corey, you say that there were form letters being sent?
If you look on the submissions online, you'll see there's a very large number of two specific types of form letters being sent.
I do want to raise a point. I have a problem with that term, dear appreciation. I appreciate dear, and I also appreciate the problem to deal with. And I think maybe the status quo management people or something like that, anti-management, but dear appreciation is quite a misnomer because I know just what everybody appreciates dear. Maybe not that word, but if there's a better term somewhere you can come up with, that would be great.
Either. Have a year about.
Opposed to a call, that's the specific thing that they're opposing.
Oh, I don't necessarily.
In a lot of cases, it's just what they believe should be done.
So they're not saying specifically we oppose a call or we oppose.
They're for dear appreciation. It's always in favor of non-lethal.
Cocaine and also
something like that.
But that's still misleading. Because not everybody who writes under the same as property damage is going to favor a legal solution necessarily.
That's right.
Yeah. Or road safety wouldn't necessarily be a legal solution. So I think it's misleading to describe that as a group just as kind of misleading to say that your appreciation. I don't have an answer for it, but that seemed to quite fit.
It's really just a breakdown of what type of the specific subject you're receiving feedback on. It's not a breakdown of opinions. It's not saying 37% of the opinion is this, or this is just the feedback you're getting, right?
Yes.
They're just saying they don't like what it's being called.
Yeah, the spreadsheet will be, with the suggestions, will be more meaningful to you.
Can we suggest that, apart from all the other homework you have, that if any of you want to come put your mind to a better bit of terminology, feel free.
There's actually a woman who did a PhD thesis at University of Manitoba on the urban deer issue in Winnipeg. She has different terms. She did a huge survey and she used very different terms than deer appreciation. So I'll go through it and find out what she said perhaps for the next time. Terminology. On the health issues, was there anything written in there about the safety of eating deer meat in the city?
No.
Because there have been people who have been trying to eat the deer in the city. Is there any issue with that?
The fact that it's illegal?
Yeah.
Like, it is illegal.
Well, I know.
The deer that we kill out on the farm, off-season, the deer must be given to the First Nations or the food bank.
Okay.
That's it. We can't go and kill a deer and eat it for dinner. That's the regulation.
Will the food bank actually take them? Is that how the huge issue was not being
well,
able to
there is, the, what would happen would be that we would have to take it to have it processed somewhere and then it's going to be a big cost to the farmer to do that. So the easiest solution is to phone up Carl Olson and tell him to come and get some deer.
Yeah.
But I mean, the First Nations people are thrilled to get it. But
ours is trying to find a butcher that can process it.
Exactly, to take to the food bank. Yes.
Because unless they're set up specifically to do well, they can't run that through their butcher facility. Without having a totally separate section,
no.
Utensils, freezer,
right.
Specifically for all.
But the First Nations people can.
Yeah, well, anybody can if you take it home and do it yourself.
Mm-hmm.
But
legally, that's what we're required to do.
Just find a commercial processor.
There was a fellow deer farm near us up island that went out of business for that very reason.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
So they call on James Island.
that falls under, they're managed more as black tail or slash mule deer. So animals taken under that permit can either be taken under a regular hunting license or under the island permit, in which case that animal belongs to the person who killed it. So they can run that through like a home butcher or do it themselves or find somebody that is licensed facility to butcher that deer.
And 2/3 of the island is privately owned.
Right. So it's James Island is totally mm-hmm. private, but Sydney's 2/3.
And weren't the deer introduced to the James?
Yeah, turn of the century.
For hunting.
No, they were actually brought over from England to farm as a first species.
Okay.
And then he went under and they just
multiplied. Yeah.
So if there's, so that you're not allowed actually, I mean, I'm giving you the First Nations traditions, but there isn't any testing. So am I hearing that there hasn't actually been any tests that we know of?
No, I don't think there's an issue overall. Hasn't been any issues of chronic wasting disease in the province so far, period, in any species. And other than that, I don't think you'd have any issue. You know, it wouldn't be any worse pollutant level than people eating their carrots out of their backyard. So from a health point of view, eating them, I don't think it would be an issue.
Well, if we were to take one of those deer out during hunting season, in, what is it, October, November?
Yeah, no. It depends on the area, but yeah. Usually September through end of November.
Yeah, then we can keep
those first. License. Pardon? Do you need a hunting license?
Even oh, you need about 20 licenses. It's a year-long process to get a license.
Uh-huh. Like so there is a hunting season in Saanich.
Mm-hmm.
It's a generic.
Central Saanich.
Yes.
Well, we would know that better than I would.
The province is divided into management units, right? So Saanich Peninsula falls under, I think it's 1-1 management unit. So that area is open for a set specific time. But within that, you've got a myriad of municipal bylaws that prohibit discharges, hunting. You know, you need permits for this. As you would know, you've got to jump through a whole bunch of bureaucratic hoops just to be able to hunt, say, on 100 acres of land.
But that's already been established as something that you can do as long as you go through the hoops.
Yeah, but the hoops don't always work either. Like, you can apply for permits to hunt or kill these deer off season. And that's where I was saying if you kill any off season, they have to be donated to the First Nations people or the food bank. That can be done. That's quite a process. Quite a process. And you have a limit. There's a 5-year limit.
But there is a legal process in place to calm deer off season.
There is. But the other problem with that is if you do have a piece of property here that's say a 10-acre piece that I have leased. You cannot discharge a firearm or a bow and arrow. Within a firearm within 100 meters of a fence, a road, a building, just about anything. And with a bow, it's 150 meters, I believe, isn't it?
I don't know if they moved up to 150.
Is it, Terry? Do you know?
But again, that's all municipal bylaws.
That's all municipal bylaws. So you actually have a 10-acre piece where you've got about 1/8 of an acre that a deer has to stand in before you can actually.
And you can't bait them.
You can't bait them.
It is legal to bait here in D.C. There's only two things you can't bait in British Columbia. It's bears, migratory campers.
Okay.
But it is a bit of a deer bingo to get them in the right spot.
Anyway, that's kind of interesting.
Mm-hmm. And they have increased the bag limit this year.
So
they've increased it.
Did they? As of November 14th in 2011, they increased it.
Three.
But again, you have to, that looks good on paper, but you have to look at the defined seasons, right? There's a small period, there's a small window of opportunity where you can take an antlerless deer, i.e. a doe. The rest have to be bucks in that time frame. So unless you actually take your two antlerless in that first 3 weeks, I think it is, I don't think it's even a month-long season, then you've taken that opportunity right off the shelf for the rest of the season. So you're back to the old bag limit.
perception and, you know, I had no idea that you could hunt it on the peninsula.
Well, it sounds easy, but...
Well, yeah, I'm sure. Yeah. I'm sure there are all sorts of issues.
It's very rare you would find a hunter in Central Sandwich.
Yeah.
And even at that, to say you can take 5 deer, it won't even put a dent in it. Not a dent.
And so you couldn't take 5 deer under your provincial hunting license. You would have to be hunting under that special permit.
Under special permit, yes.
You can't
so it's not, as far as you're concerned, it's not an effective.
And is that fine?
Well, no, it's not manageable. My concern is that it needs to be manageable for that to be efficient.
Yeah. So it's not proportionate to the land size at all. Any further questions? Going once?
I do have a request for next week. Any day but Wednesday for me.
That's
the only day I cannot see. Yeah.
Given that start of meeting schedule, you have two in the back. Are you asking
I've sent out the poll
as
well, so I've heard back from a few people, but not all, so.
And a question about this, you've got, these are all Wednesdays, but this is a Tuesday, May 22nd. Was that meant to be the 23rd? Okay.
Everybody, it's May
23rd.
Was that poll sent out recently, or?
Have we all agreed on a regular meeting time, 4 to 6, and it's done every week?
It depends on the time of day when we get here, I guess.
For you, or I can give them to you now and then you can put your own.
Sure.
And thank you. There's a lot of work that went into those. So
yeah.
So,
Jeff, can we just speak to something on
the
blue?
Are
you
receptive
to? We work just to fire you off an email and say,